Good afternoon. We have the pleasure of being with Dr. John Henry Clark, one of the world's most preeminent historians on Africa and African American history. Dr. Clark, today we want to deal with the history of the slave trade. First of all, could you give us an overview of Africa's place in world history before European contact?
Now, before European contact, and when we're dealing with the slave trade, we should really deal with the slave trade, or at least refer to it as an international institution that touched the life of every people on the face of the earth. When we're dealing with the African slave trade, we have to deal with the different periods. We have to deal with the period of the Arab slave trade that started 600 years before the European slave trade. Then we must deal with how and why the African slave trade started. Now, for most of the existence of Africa, most of the time African people have been on the earth, they've been free, independent people, free of foreign domination, free of slavery. The Arab slave trade was the first massive slave trade in Africa. You have to make a clear distinction between slavery and servitude. Concurrent with European feudalism, systems of servitude existed all over the world. China, India, and some of these systems still existed. But these systems of servitude had nothing to do with and did not resemble chattel slavery. Up until the Roman period, when the Romans, with the pressure of Islam, were driven out of Africa, most African states were independent states. We're not talking about nation states similar to the artificial borders that's in most African states of the day, or the nation states of Europe, or the nation states in the United States. We're talking about states with loose borders. We're talking about states with cultural borders as against geographical borders. Mm-hmm. Africa had a pretty reasonable time of it, in as much as you had a society that dictated the land could not be bought or sold. It was the collective property of a whole people as against that of a given landlord. Therefore, feudalism could not develop. Mm-hmm. Now, while there was domination, there was no land grabbing and land ownership to the point where no man could find enough land to feed his family. With the coming of the Arab domination of the land, and with the coming of people who began to claim title to the land, mm-hmm. and with the offsprings of the Arabs claiming title to their father's land, both in West and inner West Africa and large parts of East Africa, you begin to find a form of landlordism that began to resemble European feudalism. Mm-hmm. Now, once this was challenged by the coming of the European did not come to Africa looking for land at first. He came looking for trade at mm-hmm. first, legitimate trade to the point where the slave trade really wasn't necessary. The Europeans were using and enslaving other Europeans, and had that system of slavery worked out, the enslavement of the African would not have been massive.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Clark, let me ask you, I wanted to clarify Africans' role in world events at that time.
No, Africans had played a major role. See, it is hard for a lot of people to imagine, but Africa, up until the Greek and Roman invasion, Africa was the center of the world.
Mm-hmm. That's what I want to
look at. It was the commercial center of the world. It was the intellectual center of the world. Mm-hmm. It was the culture center of the world.
Mm-hmm.
It was the supply. It was the world's last great geographical reserve, you know.
In comparison, what was Europe like? And when we're talking about Europe, and I'm separating Europe right now from Greece and Rome.
We need to separate Europe from Greece and Rome because Greece and Rome was not a European creation,
mm-hmm.
but a Mediterranean creation. It got its stimulation mm-hmm. from North Africa and Western Asia. There was no Europe as such
mm-hmm.
for many years. The Germans had united. England had barely united. When they finally united, they united over after a series of wars,
mm-hmm.
the Hundred Year War, the War of the Roses, and they fought over nothing.
What was Europe doing at this particular time? And now we're talking about going back to early B.C.
To be absolutely honest with you, if you take out Rome and Greece,
mm-hmm.
there is no B.C. Europe of consequence to talk about.
Mm-hmm. So the Europe as we know it today came into formation when?
They came into formation in early in the century with the rise of formalized Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying that they did not exist,
mm-hmm.
but they did not exist with the present borders and under the present name.
So they made no impact in terms of world culture and contributions to the development of civilized man.
Not even to themselves did they make a contribution. And they made no contribution to anything until they enjoyed the cross-fertilization of contact with other people mm-hmm. that gave them a stimulation.
Mm-hmm. And in comparison with Africa, which was ancient by this time,
ancient, old, and a little tired.
Okay.
And tired because Africa had carried the freedom burden and the civilization burden on its shoulders for over 5,000 years now.
Mm-hmm.
And its institutions were some of them were getting a little threadbare.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people were getting a little tired of the maintenance. So and they got careless.
Let
the foreigner in.
So the first foreigners were Greeks
Greeks and Romans, the first foreigners of any consequence. But the first foreigners to do damage was from Western Asia, mistakenly called the Middle East. And
Who were these Western Asians? What kind of people were they? Were they African people, black people?
If you look at Western Asia and look at how the geography impinges on Africa,
mm-hmm.
you can walk from one to the other without crossing water.
Mm-hmm.
And if you read a book called When Egypt Ruled the East, you will know that that geography was what ruled by Africa.
All right, so we're talking about literally the same people. I've read that there was two Ethiopias. Not only the Ethiopia landmass that we call Ethiopia today, but historically Ethiopia stretched all the way to what we today call the Middle East.
It stretched into Arabia and into Yemen, what we now call Kuwait.
Mm-hmm.
an Ethiopian emperor named Abraha, with two Abrahas,
mm-hmm.
conquered Yemen. Another Ethiopian emperor by the same name, 800 A.D., pulled the Ethiopian Coptic Church out from under the tutelage of the northern Egyptian Coptic Church,
mm-hmm.
therefore making Ethiopia a strong, independent Christian church. Ethiopia having been converted in about the 3rd century, you know, A.D.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, these states began to function independent. The once foreign influence began to hit North Africa. The nations to the south, who had cooperation with Egypt, began to resent that foreign influence and began to pull away from Egypt.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So if we take a look at Africa, prior to European entry into Africa, we only have contact with two non-African entities, and that is Greece and Rome. And what period are we talking about now that Greece and Rome began to make their first impact?
Now, Greece became aware of Africa in its early folk literature about 1250 B.C. in the book called The Odyssey and the Iliad,
mm-hmm.
Written by someone called Homer. We're not too clear whether Homer was man or woman, you know, mm-hmm. or whether he existed at all,
mm-hmm.
or whether someone just picked something up and slapped the name Homer on it.
Mm-hmm.
But they became aware of the mysterious Africans. And they painted the Africans up, depicted the Africans as mysterious people with a big eye in the middle of the face, you know,
mm-hmm.
with one big eye in the middle of the face. They had their whole mythology wrong. But the strange thing about this kind of mythology, it was respectful.
Mm-hmm.
They respected the fact that a black people existed someplace who was awesome.
Mm. Then what role did Africa play in the formation of Greek philosophy and Greek thinking?
No,
and of course the,
this would be later when with Africa became really the training school for a lot of these Greek thinkers.
Mm-hmm.
This is what's so well recorded in George M. James' little book, Stolen Legacy.
Mm-hmm.
And in the religious aspect is enjoyed is in Dr. Ben Yakinen's work, African Origins of Major Western Religions, mm-hmm. and in John Jackson's book, Christianity Before Christ.
Mm-hmm. Well, what was Greece like in comparison to Africa during the period that we are talking about around 1200 B.C.?
1200 B.C., Greece was getting it together, but they had not formed a pure state. It was small city-states. Some of them came together,
mm-hmm.
at time of war, and some of them didn't. And Greece didn't get it together until she could warm her hands figuratively and literally,
mm-hmm.
at the intellectual fires,
mm-hmm.
of Africa.
And so Greece then came into Africa as students to learn at the great universities. And of course, Africa was ancient at that time. All the pyramids
was already ancient. And I think we really need to go over Herodotus again, because he tells us about the connection between, mm-hmm. the Greeks and the Africans. And one time an African scholar lost patience and said, "You Greeks are children. Mm-hmm. You're always forgetting what we learn, what we teach you."
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So the Africans were actually the teachers.
The teachers.
Of the Greeks.
And the last one that the African would teach would be Aristotle.
Mm-hmm.
See, Alexander, called Alexander the Great, was a student of Aristotle. And he collected a lot of the books in Africa and sent it to Aristotle,
mm-hmm.
who edited it and plagiarized and put his name on a lot of books he didn't write.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Clark, looking at Africa's role, predominance in world history at this time, and Greece being a smaller and younger nation, how did Africa lose her world dominance?
See, Africa lost her world dominance because of something that happened then that is still happening. Africa has always suffered from a political naivete.
Mm-hmm.
Africa has always been hospitable to strangers without examining the intention of the stranger.
Mm-hmm.
And very often the stranger is in the house before the African asks, are you loyal to this house?
Mm-hmm. So she allowed everybody to come in and treated them.
The open-mindedness
uh-huh.
of the African in this regard.
Mm-hmm. Africa allowed that many strangers, foreigners, into her land that it could literally build a base to effect an overthrow of the country.
The Hyksos, later called Shepherd Kings, they came into Africa, at least North and Northeast Africa. They came in as friends and colonizers. They were there for two generations.
Mm-hmm.
They had no loyalty to the Africans, so they went back and told their friends back home where the weak spots were, how to invade. And they had married African women by now, and they had not changed national loyalty.
Mm-hmm. I had read that Dr. Ben had done some work that established the Hyksos as being a black people.
He's done, this is some of his new research and some of the research he went there for. And it proved that Keith Seeley and his group could have been right. And for Keith Seeley, wasn't too happy about black people ruling anything. He had to admit that the same people who were ruling Egypt also ruled Western Asia.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Whether he admitted that they were black or not is irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
They were African in culture, and subsequently there had to be some variety of African in appearance.
Yes. So Africa begins to wane in its power and in its glory, and it is conquered and dominated, at least North Africa, by Greece, which was the first, the beginning of the real civilization.
No, see, Africa has had what I call three golden ages, and it could have a fourth one. The first golden age was from the rise of Imhotep and King and Pharaoh Zusa,
mm-hmm.
and the third dynasty, 2800 BC.
Oh, hold on, Dr. Clark, let's take a break. And that Africa had three golden ages and could have a fourth.
The first golden age was from the third dynasty, with the rise of the Pharaoh Zusa and the great commoner Imhotep,
mm-hmm.
the father of medicine, the great master builder, the multi-genius, to the invasion of Africa by the
Hyso
in 1675.
What were some of the accomplishments during that time, if I can ask you? Was the
accomplishment during the time is that from the third dynasty through the sixth dynasty was the great pyramid building age.
Mm-hmm.
And from the sixth through the 12th was the great temple building age.
So we would then, when we say it was the great pyramid building age, we would know then that the Africans would have had to have mastered mathematics, science.
They would have to have mastered all of the sciences, otherwise the pyramids wouldn't be there.
Mm-hmm.
They would have to measure weights and measures. They'd also have to master something else, which I assume, without being able to prove, they would have to have mastered hydraulics.
Yes, I agree with you. Because there's a new book out now which establishes the pyramids as being a device to control, to purify and control the actual flow of the Nile River. Not the flow of the Nile River, but it purified the water and enabled internal dikes to open and to control the underground water which came up at Elephant Head. Mm-hmm. I'm just getting into it, but it does...
Well, I haven't read the book, but the author has called me. He's going to deliver a copy here, and I'm going to go over it. But the pyramid served a lot of purposes other than the burial place.
Yes.
For the king.
Right, and symbolizes the highest, at least the apex of the accumulation of knowledge on the face of the earth at that time.
It was the greatest achievement in building in human history.
Until today?
These were master engineers. We have not built anything anywhere that equals the pyramid.
Yes, I mean today?
Today, nothing. Name everything. Name everything in the world that you can think of. Empire State Building, anything else. Name it all.
World Trade Center. Well, why?
None of it equals.
Why?
Because one is higher than the other. When you look at the World Trade Building, you look at Empire State Building, all you got is formula.
Mm-hmm.
An architect picks up a form and follows the form.
Yes.
The pyramid, you've got genius that was working on the spot and could not have been formalized.
Could not have been formalized?
Because they started out doing something. They didn't, they weren't totally sure.
I see.
And worked it out.
I see. So all of the computations that are related to the movement of the planets and the stars and which
they were working it out all at the same time. They knew a whole lot, but they worked the rest of it out in process.
Okay. I just want...
Not only a great project for public works, while the river was overflowing and depositing its rich soil along the banks, but a great project for learning.
Yes. I was just trying to get a view of African people and African governmental processes to establish what Africa was like before European contact. So in looking at
the pyramids, all we have dealt with is the extreme ancient period.
Mm-hmm.
And all we've dealt with the first phase of, the first golden age.
Mm-hmm.
Now after the coming of the Hyksos and the recovery, Africa has 1,000 years of peace.
After the invasion of the Hyksos.
After the expelled.
Yes.
1,000 years undisturbed. mm-hmm. where they start building again.
And this is the period they built the great temples of Luxor and Karnak and
great schools. Mm-hmm. Although all of these things were started, you know, with, you know, the if there's one set of buildings in Egypt, it was probably built from the genius of the Sudan.
Mm-hmm.
It's Karnak.
Yes, I've been there.
It's Karnak.
And what does that symbolize, this Karnak temple, for people who may not know?
See, at Karnak, it was one of the earth. See, the African has built many holy lands.
Yes.
It was an early place of worship.
Mm-hmm.
See, the African built many holy lands before Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
Now, blacks understood that they would never call Jerusalem holy land.
Mm-hmm.
But the oldest city in Africa that the Africans built solely for worship is Abydos.
Yes.
And Abydos has never been torn down, never been rebuilt, and it's still there.
Still standing. And that is where many of the religious concepts, both in Christianity, in Islam, in Judaism,
that they were formed,
so forth, were formulated
before the religious concepts that went into the making mm-hmm. of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam.
So not only did Africa give to the world math and science, but religion, which was formalized and...
No, it gave to the world the spirituality that was formalized and codified as Judaism, Christianity, and Islam.
All right.
And dogmatized.
Okay. Let's talk about the second great glorious age.
No, this was...
We are talking about
the second glorious. We're into it now.
Yes.
Because we're talking about the age of recovery.
Mm-hmm.
And what did they do with that recovery? From the 17th dynasty through the mighty 18th into the mighty 9th, the 18th, which I call the greatest dynasty ever to sit on any throne at any time in history.
Why?
At the top of this dynasty stood the great, the Thutmose family.
Mm-hmm.
Coming immediately after, was part of that same family, was the first great female ruler of history, where we have a record, Hatshepsut.
Mm-hmm.
After her, her great brother, who she stayed his hand in power, but told him what power was.
Mm-hmm.
She kept him out of power for 21 years, but for 21 years he got nothing but training and how to handle power. When he came to power, he was one of the greatest pharaohs ever happened.
Was Africa?
And after him,
mm-hmm.
the great religious reformer, Imhotep the fourth, known to the world as Akhenaten. Mm-hmm. And near the end of that dynasty came the teenage king that I often refer to as a minor king who had a major funeral, King Tut.
Now, up until this time, we're talking about a strictly black Africa.
No, we should not bear down too hard on the word black,
mm-hmm.
because there were varieties of colors in Africa. And the main point is all of these colors were molded by African culture.
Mm-hmm. Are they indigenous?
Indigenous Africans molded by African culture. They mm-hmm. didn't come from Asia,
mm-hmm.
and they were not mixed bloods.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They were mixed with other Africans,
mm-hmm.
but they weren't mixed with any foreigners.
Mm-hmm. So Africa has produced on its own soil, out of its own belly, all colors.
Are
we saying that?
Yes. You've got light-skinned Zulus who are not mixed with Arabs,
mm-hmm.
and not mixed with whites. You got jet black Zulus.
Mm-hmm.
The light-skinned Zulu is not less of a Zulu
mm-hmm.
than the jet black Zulu.
Mm-hmm.
We're so taken with color in this country, we make something to do of it. They don't make anything to do with one way or the other.
Mm-hmm.
You got light-skinned Yorubas, light-skinned Igbos.
So color,
you don't have a whole lot of them. You might find in all Nigeria, you might find 1,000.
In all of Nigeria?
You might find 1,000, you know.
And they're indigenous too?
They're indigenous. Speak the same language, same custom.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Then you might find, I have seen in Nigeria, a sprinkling of a Bano.
Yes.
I don't know how that came about, but their lip formation, the facial formation is identical with that of
Africa.
Africa.
Well let me ask you about this type now. We're not talking about a European physical type when we talk about light-skinned Africans with a skinny nose and a thin lip and a straight hair,
you,
blonde eyes.
You've got Africans with thin nose, thin lips, who are jet black. How many Somalis have you seen?
Yes, that's true. Mm-hmm.
And yet they didn't get it from mixing with Europeans or Arabs.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And you got a similar strain in Ethiopia.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to be clear about what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so that we have to pull back a little bit on this word black.
Mm-hmm.
And let's deal with the word African culture.
All right, I understand.
They are of African culture.
Yes. And the culture, of course, then takes in a way of thinking, a religious cosmology, a way of life that involves a different perspective than Euro.
And a different commitment.
Than the European cultural motif.
Mm.
Okay, in the second glorious age of Africa.
Now we're talking about the second now. Now we got to talk about the third. After the Romans disgraced themselves trying to handle a religion called Christianity that didn't fit the European character then, don't fit the European character now.
Mm-hmm.
A camel boy began to grumble, and he asked for reform. Failing to get reform, he asked for a new religion.
Mm-hmm.
That religion was Islam, a military religion. They drove the Romans back into Europe. Now Europe had to feed on itself.
But this is the third glorious age of Africa?
I'm how it began.
Okay.
And
what period are we talking about now?
We're talking about...
I mean, what year?
We're talking about, although the period of true greatness began in this record around the 3rd century A.D., the rise of Islam started around the 7th century A.D.
Okay, so between the 2nd and the 3rd glorious age of A.D., we've had an invasion by Greece and Rome of Africa and the decline of Northern Africa.
We've had Greece and Rome, and we've had Rome, the Greeks didn't stay very long.
Mm-hmm.
Many of the Greeks settled and stayed, period. Many of the poor Greeks were making out better in Africa, so they decided better stay there.
Mm-hmm.
They integrated into the desert people, and some of them became Arabs, you know.
Okay.
The Arab is partly of Greek descent.
Mm-hmm.
Arab of today.
So
the
he's a
today,
mixture of Greek
the,
and Arab.
The Arab of today is probably the most authentic bastard on the face of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
He's a mixture of several things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
All right. Now with Rome gone, with the Mediterranean under control of the Africans and the Arabs and the Berbers, with Africans controlling Spain and the Mediterranean, in the markets of the Mediterranean, these markets no longer in Europeans' hands. Europe has to look inside of itself now for markets and for mobility. And this would continue from the 7th century almost to the 17th century. Europe would have a flutter with the Crusades.
Yes.
And outside of Europe, they would discover that people had moved ahead of them.
Mm-hmm.
People had fabrics.
Mm-hmm.
Europe didn't have.
Mm-hmm.
And people had something some Europeans had not even heard about.
Mm-hmm.
Soap.
Soap?
Soap.
Washing soap.
Washing soap.
Are you saying the Europeans didn't bathe? They didn't?
No.
I mean, really?
No. Look, there's a book on it. I got it downstairs. It's called Dirt.
I'm not laughing.
It's a history of sanitation.
I haven't heard it before.
It's a history of sanitation.
Mm-hmm.
It was only until the end of the 19th century that Louis Pasteur convinced European doctors to wash their hands before they moved from one patient to another.
So Europe was literally the most backwards.
Europe was backward when they began to enslave us. They were still back during that period.
What?
But they were enslaving backward Europeans, concurrent with enslaving us.
Mm. What do you mean, enslaving backwards Europeans?
Europeans were enslaved to other Europeans.
Well, let's talk about the slave trade, and then let's get into that. Let's establish first the decline of Africa when slavery first began. When did slavery first begin, and who began slavery in Africa?
Well, the massive enslavement of Africans began with the that was enslavement of Africans in East Africa before the rise of Islam, because the Arabs felt called on to furnish soldiers for the Iranians.
Mm-hmm.
Then in control of India.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The Iranians did not trust local soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
So they hired mercenaries and slaves. Many of these Africans...
So they hired them at first.
Hired them at first. Mercenaries and slaves.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
For labor and for soldiering. Many of these Africans rose to high position in India. One, Malacca, became governor of Bengal.
Mm-hmm.
And another one, Ganges, had a river named after him.
Oh, what period are we talking about now?
We're talking about now the period the Iranians went into India in the early period before Christ. Soon after, they were driven back from Africa. See, the Cambyses invasion from Iran happened in 550 BC.
Okay.
We're talking about a period between 550 BC and the birth of Christ.
All right.
Okay, and that continued, but when the Arabs lost Spain, Africans and the Arabs lost Spain, the Arabs began to enslave the very Africans that had been the military heart of their control over Spain. But people are never grateful to us. People never return our compliment.
Mm-hmm.
And people never pay us for our favors. The Africans began to enslave the Africans. And when the Portuguese came around...
You mean the Arabs began to...
The Arabs began to enslave the Africans. And when the Portuguese came around to... was driven out of West Africa, came around to East Africa, the Portuguese slave trade moving from the south met the Arab slave trade moving from the north, and they found the partnership. And most of these slaves went to Brazil.
Now, the Portuguese slave trade was a European slave trade.
It was a European slave trade.
But the Arabs had already been enslaving Africans for how long?
Since about the late 600. They were enslaving before the rise of Islam.
Mm-hmm. Now, when we say Arabs, can we name countries that we can identify here as being the main proponents of the Arab slave trade?
The main proponents of the East African slave trade was the Omani Arabs. Find the name Oman on the map.
Mm-hmm.
Find the name Kuwait on the map.
Mm-hmm.
And you have find the basic area. Now remember, when the Prophet Muhammad was born, half of Arabia was an Ethiopian colony.
All right, so we are talking about then a primarily Africanized Arab?
We're talking about an Africanized Arab who participated in the slave trade. We're talking about an Africanized Arab who was literally created for the slave trade.
Explain, Dr. Clark.
The Arab moved down the coast of East Africa, marrying African women, and because the Arab was not permitted to go inland, and it was spotted on sight. After two generations of this sexual conquest,
mm-hmm.
he had produced a black-looking Arab who moved inland and facilitated the East African slave trade. A good work on this is UNESCO documents 2, Slavery in the Indian Ocean.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right. So now we have how many years of Arab slave trade?
You got Arab slave trade from 7. We got a few hundred years before the rise of Islam. And after the rise of Islam, in the 7th century, you have the Arab slave trade right straight up into the 15th and the 16th century, when they lost Spain and rekindled the slave trade. Now the slave trade is coming into inner West Africa through North Africa.
Mm-hmm.
The best authority on this is an English scholar now at Northwestern. His name is John O. Hunwick.
Mm-hmm.
He's written on the African diaspora in the Muslim world. I have his article in there,
mm-hmm.
in my library downstairs, rather. Because I made a special point of, see, as a professional teacher, you simply cannot afford to say what you cannot document.
So you have documented all that we talk about.
I have to. I'll go out of the business.
I understand.
These are things people don't want to believe, don't believe, and don't want to believe.
Mm-hmm.
And to stay a professional teacher, I have to legitimize the public statements that I made.
Mm-hmm. So, Dr. Clark, now that we've had several hundred years of the Arab slave trade, what impact did that have on weakening Africa in lieu of the European slave trade?
The Arab slave trade drained Africa of the energy and the organization that it needed to stop the European slave trade. Literally, the Arab slave trade prepared Africa for the European slave trade, referred to as the Atlantic slave trade. The Arab slave trade from North Africa into inner West Africa was devastating. The Arab slave trade did not function along the coast of West Africa, and this disorganization spread to the West African states, and the European took advantage of some African systems of servitude that had nothing to do with sending people out of Africa.
Explain. You're saying that there was servitude in Africa, but it was different from the kind of servitude.
Totally different. You never broke up families.
Mm-hmm.
And it was always a period when you could get out.
Mm-hmm.
After so many years, you could go home.
Mm-hmm.
It was no chattel slavery to the end of the day, your days. In some cases, slaves married into the family in which they were slaves. In one case, especially mm-hmm. in Nigeria,
mm-hmm.
a slave named Jaja became a king twice in one lifetime. Having been a slave twice in one lifetime, he became a king twice in one lifetime and ruled a state in the upper Niger called Opobo.
So we're talking about major differences between African servitude.
So don't even be talking about the same, both of them in the same breath.
Mm-hmm.
And Jar Jar became so powerful, he bankrupted the British palm oil business in the 18th century.
And he was an African slave, a slave of one
slave
African
to one
to
African house.
Yeah.
And this house wanted to play a trick on a rival house
mm-hmm.
because he was so unruly. They said, let me give him over. And kings always give each other's presents.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to give him a present to that king. Let him drive him crazy. And so he went to the rival house. He calmed down.
Uh-huh.
And became the chief merchant for the king. At 19, he was handling the equivalent of $50,000 a year.
And there was a lot of money during that time. When we look back at that time.
In the palm oil business.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when the king died, the sons were making so much money in the palm oil, they decided that they ain't going to leave all this lucrative business to be king. So, he said, he was our father's favorite. Let him be king.
We're talking about this kind of a mentality that African had for its people's servitude.
You know what?
That they were literally not looked at that much different than other people in the community or within the compound of the society.
No.
So we are really, then man didn't lose his dignity, he didn't lose his humanity.
He didn't lose his family connections.
And he didn't lose his family connections.
Some Africans are clannish, like the Musi, mm. who boasted they are homogeneous. This is, we not only don't integrate other Africans into our blood, we don't even integrate their cows.
You mean they kept the cows from
kept the cows. Mix your blood with my cow. If you want a wife, go home. Get your wife and bring her back.
Is this still a custom of the Mooses?
It's still a custom. They talk about everything now, including calendars, everything. They marry fresh women. Go to France for education. Come back with fresh women. Oh, the Moose is all mixed up now. But he still boasts about it. He still boasts about the days when he still boasts about being the most homogeneous. The Somalis do the same thing. So if you ever in Africa, ever in Africa, and tell you he's the most homogeneous, don't argue with any of them.
Uh-huh.
Because you go in the next corner, the next one going to tell you the same thing.
But this is important, Dr. Clark, because now we get to see that Africa is not homogeneous and that the different cultures of Africa had their own prejudice against other groups in Africa.
No, let us not call it prejudice, because they didn't hate them.
But they thought
they were. They didn't beat up on them.
Okay, that's important.
It's preference.
Yeah, their own preference, but they were not engaging in intertribal wars.
They weren't engaged in fighting the one. They didn't.
They were not, because that's the picture we've gotten.
They
fought each other all the time and sold.
No, they didn't fight each other all the time. There were some so-called tribal wars, but not over that issue.
Uh-huh.
in the Herero Wall in what is now Namibia is a good example. Mm-hmm. Was when those Germans drove 60,000 Herero women into the desert, said cohabit or die, because the German wanted to create a bastard race.
Mm-hmm.
The Hereros and the Mambas, all the other groups got together. They're getting together right now.
Mm-hmm. And that sparked that war. But that was not a war between Africans and Africans. I'm trying to get a picture of the intertribal wars. Were there a lot of them? Did they exist?
No.
How devastating were they?
No matter how you research it, most of the so-called intertribal wars started with the coming of the Europeans.
So before the coming of the Europeans, Africa was not engaged in inter-conflict.
They had inter-conflict, but the bitter, devastating inter-tribal wars they did not have.
I had heard that before Shaka, most of the inter-tribal conflicts, and I don't know why we call them inter-tribal, because Africans did not consider themselves tribes.
If Africans don't consider themselves tribes, everybody came out of a tribe. French is a tribe. And so it would be respectable if you use it for everybody. If you're not going to use it for everybody, I wouldn't use it for anybody.
Let's call them nations, then.
No, well, I refer to Africans as, when I refer to an Asante, as the Asante people.
All right.
I refer to the culture base. I use the culture base as a reference.
But what I wanted to ask you, before Shaka, and that would be before the coming of the European, because Shaka was trying to bring Africa together to fight the European, but before
that, to save it from the European, he didn't necessarily want to fight them. His main thing is to save the land, to keep them from taking the land.
Mm-hmm.
And he was trying to convince other Africans that you have to join me. If we're going to achieve this, you have to join me. Mm-hmm. When you fail to join me in this regard, then I have to fight you.
But before that, in the wars between Africans and Africans, very few men were ever killed in those wars. Sometimes
if the casualties were as high as 12, that was a big battle. That was a monumental battle. 12 men got killed.
So how can they have a war and the casualties are so low?
But 12 was a big casualty.
So then they had wars in which no one was killed.
It was a contest. If you look at the role of magic in the development of religion,
mm-hmm.
If you're one kind of priest, I'm another kind of priest, we have a difference of opinion. I bring my magician, you bring your magician.
Mm-hmm.
You see, who can outfox the other?
Mm-hmm.
So I respect if people just sit there and judge, you know, the foxing, the role of the magicians.
Other words, and we have not really gotten a clear perspective on African values and the principles in which African governed herself by.
Yeah.
That was really a weakness that allowed for the European to come in, because
the African transferred to the European some of the humanity he had for himself.
Yes.
Not knowing that the European did not have the same humanity.
So when the European came in with both a demonic respect for life and also the gun, the African was at a really serious disadvantage.
And he still is. He still is at a serious disadvantage in that regard. And unfortunately, I think the African educated in Europe who have dropped his Africanness trying to be civilized may also be doing Africa more harm than good.
Mm-hmm.
George Lennon said something to me years ago while having breakfast in my home. George Lennon was mildly drunk at the time. Mm-hmm. But Lennon is such a brilliant mind. And he just is brilliant, half drunk. More brilliant, half drunk, than most men are dead sober.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you need a generation of Africans educated in Africa by other Africans for the sole purpose of serving Africa.
I agree with that. I agree with that. Mm-hmm. Let's go back to the slave trade. How devastating, once the European slave trade got underway, did it conflict in any way with the Arab slave trade that they...
It didn't conflict with it in the East, because the Arab slave trade cooperated with the European, with the Portuguese slave trade.
They cooperated?
With the Portuguese slave trade in the East, East mm-hmm. Africa.
Mm-hmm.
The British came into this area pretending that their role was to stop the slave trade. And the British made a contribution towards stopping it, only to start another kind of slave trade called colonialism.
Mm-hmm. So then the Africans were duped, undermined by both the Arabs having been under attack by the Arabs, and the Europeans coming in and further gaining
the
a certain
Africa
trust.
The Africans didn't understand that none of them meant any good.
How did Christianity impact or play a role with the coming of the European in its further subjugation of Africa?
That's another fault of the African. He likes to play with the foreign toys of other people.
Mm.
And the Christianity that the European gave the African wasn't as good as the moral and spiritual way of life the African already had.
Mm-hmm.
Some Africans are awakening to this fact today. This is well outlined in a book called The Role of the Missionaries in Conquest, and in a new book simply called The Missionaries.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So during the time of this slave trade, how many Africans would you say was lost to the Asian slave trade, and then how many was lost to the European slave trade?
Asian slave trade is difficult to record. The UNESCO documents two dealing with just one period of the Arab slave trade, and say from 35 to 40 million during that period.
35 to 40,
40
million Africans?
From just East Africa alone. W.E.B. Du Bois, in his work, The Suppression of the African Slave Trade to the United States,
mm-hmm.
says from 60 to 100 million Africans were taken out of Africa, not counting those who died.
Lord have mercy. Are we talking about both the Arab and the European slave trade?
No, we're talking about the European alone at this figure.
Uh-huh.
There's a new figures by an African, a Nigerian, who's checked the logs of the slave ships,
mm-hmm.
the intro, how many they loaded on, how many they sold. This new man is called Nkoro, like E.A. Nkoro. His work is in a magazine in Nigeria called Tariq.
Just change that, you don't have to stop doubling. Go ahead, Dr. Clark.
Brian Davis, Brian, the professor at Cornell, has done some good work on this, and his Slavery in Western Civilization, and another book, Slavery in the Age of Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
John Blasingame's work, The Slave Community, while he did not deal with figures, he deals with the situation quite well.
Yeah, look like I can hear you.
We need to look to our historians. We need to read Orlando Patterson's early work, The Sociology of Slavery, and his latest work on the subject, Slavery and Social Death.
Slavery and Social Death?
Mm-hmm. Both Harvard University Press.
Mm-hmm.
Orlando is a Jamaican. He's a little smug, like most educated Jamaicans. Impossible sometimes. A lot of these people who are impossible for other people to get along with don't give me no problems.
Mm-hmm.
But they know they're better not.
Yeah, I love that. I like that. Dr. Clark, when we think of 150 million plus Africans having been removed from the African continent, it is easily the greatest Holocaust ever on the human family on the face of the earth.
In the history of the world.
In the history of the world.
History of the world is the Holocaust. Transcending the casualties in the First and the Second World War.
You're saying that there were more, yes, there were far more casualties than the First and Second World War put together.
Yeah.
Let me ask you, Dr. Clark, what contribution did Africa make to the development of America, these Africans who were brought here as slaves?
Well, the African made a major contribution to the development of the Americas. His labor given against his will not only developed the plantation system, but the plantation system in turn, especially in the Caribbean islands, Haiti and Jamaica, was a major factor in the economic recovery of Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, Europe had dumped a whole lot of white people into the New World, a whole lot of white servants too. And that labor just didn't work out. And had it worked out, they would have used more white slaves,
mm-hmm.
along with blacks.
Mm-hmm.
There's an excellent chapter on this in Lerone Bennett's book, White, on the Shaping of Black America. And the chapter is called White Servitude.
Mm-hmm.
He points out that the blacks could have been a third people in chain, because at first it was the Indian, and second it was the indentured whites.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you're saying then that the African, literally, its contribution is the establishment, the building, the clearing of land that was a swamp,
an
acre of land, then becomes tremendously important.
And the railroad systems. And
blacks built the railroad system?
In the South especially.
Mm-hmm.
And the Irish and other immigrant groups built most of those in the West.
Mm-hmm.
The blacks built and maintained those in the South and still do.
Mm-hmm. What other kind of contributions could one look to that Africans made in terms of their presence here in America as slaves?
Very obvious is in the field of inventions. And inventions of labor-saving devices.
Mm-hmm. For instance?
Latimer's contribution to the filament that went into the making of the electric light.
Mm-hmm.
And black invention of basic things like the lawnmower, the hat rack, the spit tune. When you are rich and smoking a cigar and spitting all over the floor and say, boy, wipe that out, boy, do this.
Mm-hmm.
It's time to reason you will invent a spit tune.
That's true.
You right. Ain't coming in, boy, hang up my coat. Stand to reason you would invent a hat rack.
Yes. And the cotton gin, the same.
Yeah. Stand to reason.
So,
some of our greatest contribution was the invention of labor-saving devices and our early contribution to the electrical industry. Mm-hmm. mm-hmm. and communication. Mm-hmm. Wasn't for Granville Woods, there'd be no Western House of today, and no General Electric.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't be there. And except for Latimer also, I don't think Granville would have brought off the telephone. The principal for the telephone was brought off. But the one thing Granville had to do, he had to draw and explain every functioning part.
Mm-hmm.
He was no draftsman.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That was Latimer's job.
Mm-hmm.
And that got the phone on the way.
I see.
Although he was really trying to invent a hearing aid for his wife.
Really? Dr. Clark, in terms of the economy of the country, what impact did Africa via slavery make on the tremendous wealth of America?
Well, it made, beyond cotton, made an impact on the economy in timber and hides. If you got the labor of an entire people for 300 years and can't get your economic show on the road, you have to be backward.
How many Africans were brought here, made it here in terms of not those that left Africa, but those that went through the Middle Passage and actually became slaves in America?
At the end of this Civil War, there was about 4 to 6 million in the southern states, and that was close to 1 million in the northern states.
Mm-hmm.
We try to avoid admitting that really the proving ground, the breaking ground for slavery was the Caribbean islands.
Oh, so.
And the holding station, the Caribbean islands. They would take them there and brutalize them and break them in. It's like you're breaking in a horse.
Mm-hmm.
Before they were shipped to the United States.
So there were more slaves in the Caribbean islands?
No, but the slaves in the Caribbean islands forever in transit.
Uh-huh.
Once they're processed, they would take it to markets in South America and in the United States and in Central America.
Mm-hmm.
So they won. There was always a stationary group of slaves. It was always adding to that stationary group.
So at any given point, there were probably at least a few million slaves given labor for over a period of 300 years in America.
Yeah.
And so the economy of this country up until the day benefits from the slave labor, unpaid Africans.
It still benefits from it because early in the week or last week I lectured in Brooklyn to senior citizens, it was mostly white and Jewish. And they kept crying out, we had nothing to do with the slave trade. Why should we, be worried about it? And I said that you still benefit from it.
Mm-hmm.
There's still doors that open automatically on your whiteness,
mm-hmm.
and close automatically on my blackness.
Yes.
So the aftermath of slavery is still with us.
Not only that, all the wealth which was accumulated during slavery has been passed down to the generations of whites who have come after. So
we got no.
The 300 years of free labor has enabled them to be the most wealthy country on the face of the earth, in which they inherited.
So we've got no big entrepreneur generation, and no big entrepreneur money.
Mm-hmm.
Sporadically here and there, we've got a few millionaires, but, nothing of consequence. And nothing that they can't destroy overnight if they decide to do so.
Mm-hmm. Were blacks ever allowed to inherit property and wealth like whites? Not during slavery. I mean, blacks were never allowed to pass. They had never had any wealth to pass
down there. They never had that caliber of wealth.
Mm-hmm.
They never had the Rockefeller caliber of wealth, or the Mellon caliber of wealth, or the Carnegie caliber of wealth. Although some blacks have had considerable wealth.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you one other question going back to slavery, which we skipped. The millions of Africans, we're talking about 150 million, so why couldn't Africa mount some kind of a very formidable resistance? How many Europeans went into Africa? Do we have any idea? I can't quite understand.
They were small in comparison to the African, but they had something the Africans did not have, and that is the gun. As for resistance, the Africans' resistance was consistency.
Mm-hmm.
250 slave revolts in the United States alone, and consistent revolts throughout the Caribbean and South America. I've cataloged this.
I'll ask you the question again. Dr. Clark, in terms of the number of Africans that were 150 millions and up, and the number of Africans that were on the continent, why couldn't they have mounted a united offensive and repelled the Europeans, since I am sure there were far less Europeans on the African continent fighting Africans than there were Africans? What made the difference?
The difference was the gun and the intentions of the European was unknown to the Africans.
Mm-hmm.
And the African was already in the bind, and yet he still resisted.
So he did fight
back. And some of the guns, yes, and this is well recorded, and in the Caribbean islands and in South America, they seem to have fought back longer and harder with a greater degree of consistency, because they had something intact that the Africans in the United States did not have, and that is an African culture continuity. They
mm-hmm.
still remembered
mm-hmm.
where Africa was, that they came from there.
Mm-hmm.
And the European did not outlaw the drum.
Mm-hmm.
He did not outlaw all the African religions.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't encourage it, but he didn't outlaw it.
Mm-hmm.
In the United States, they outlawed every form of African expression.
Yes.
And so therefore, and then in the United States, they bought and sold in small lots and broke up the lots often.
Mm-hmm.
So if someone sells grandma and grandpa to a plantation owner, and says, they're not going to give an account of sold grandma to a place in Kansas.
Mm-hmm.
If you pick it up by accident, you pick it up by accident.
Yes.
But another thing, once grandma and grandpa get to Kansas, they might sell them again within a week. Mm-hmm. The American slavery system acted like a brokerage system.
Mm-hmm.
This was true of all states except New Orleans under the French.
Excuse me, you're going to have to go back over that again.
Mm-hmm. Why?
Okay. I wasn't rolling.
Oh, all right. All right, start rolling.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Dr. Clark. The question was, with 150 million Africans being taken from the continent of Africa and millions more on the continent, why could not Africa have mounted a offensive that would have enabled her to repel Europeans, since there were less Europeans coming into Africa than there were Africans?
Well, Africans did mount an offensive of assault, but the European had a distinct advantage, and that was the rapid-firing gun, plus the fact that the European also had the service of some Africans had grown corrupt and began to benefit from the trade, mm-hmm. and assist. This went on for longer periods in spite of the fact that the Africans did resist in Africa, fought to keep from getting on the boat, fought on the boat, some jumped overboard, fought to keep from getting off the boat, and it got to their final designation. In the Caribbean islands, they fought more successfully and more consistently,
mm-hmm.
because they managed to hold on to the Africanness, because the drum was not outlawed.
Mm-hmm.
The African religious practice wasn't outlawed. It wasn't encouraged, but it wasn't outlawed.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in the United States, it was outlawed. In the United States, they bought in small lots and broke up the lots often.
Mm-hmm.
See, then when they would sell a relative to a slave master in another state, they would not tell you that your relative, your cousin, your grandma is sold to a plantation in Kansas or mm-hmm. any other state.
Mm-hmm.
You find it out by accident then.
So you had no connectedness with one another.
Yeah, and so
in many cases the language was
this
different.
This is why in the United States the loyalty system was broken.
Mm-hmm.
When you break up with people that way, you break up the cultural line, you break up the loyalty system.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Should African Americans receive reparations today, 1989?
I think they should see reparations. I'm at odds about how much myself. I'm so ambitious in this regard, I say. Give me the old treasure and I'll leave you the change.
Why so much? I mean,
well, the supreme decision is made on the fact that except for me being here, maybe you wouldn't be here in all your luxury. And I think we need to make high demands, whether we get them or not, to dramatize the gravity of the situation.
Dr. Clark, I want to thank you, and I want you to know that I agree with you,
mm-hmm.
that at this point, the only people who probably can save humanity is the African race. And I think that the African American plays a particular important role in the future of mankind. Again, I want to thank you for being with us on the African slave trade.
Thank you.
Capitalism will confuse these people. Have them totally confused. They will try every way, try different.